السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا في كما يحب ربنا ويرضى، وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، الحمد لله. Thank you guys for joining me this morning. Today is Wednesday, alhamdulillah. We're halfway through the week. And for Rawda Islamic Center of Delaware's community, on Wednesday, we like to encourage the community to donate $100 to continue supporting Rawda Islamic Center of Delaware. So I'm going to pin our Cash App down at the bottom. And if you are so inclined, and inshallah ta'ala, you can send a donation in today, inshallah ta'ala. I'll have more information for you guys on Friday, but for right now, you just need to know that Rawda Islamic Center of Delaware will be opening in January, inshallah ta'ala. Rawda Islamic Center of Delaware will be open for business in January, inshallah ta'ala. So right now, we are focusing on laying down the carpet. And as if any one of you have ever done any work at a masjid, have helped out with any masjid, then you know laying down carpet is a very expensive project. So our current project, masjid carpet project, is roughly around $12,000. All right. So the guy is going to come today. That's why I'm online early with you guys right now, because I'm going to meet the guy over at the facility so he can begin measuring, so he can take the dimensions of the floor. And our community, alhamdulillah, has, you know, made some choices in carpet. So inshallah ta'ala, today we are going to measure the space for the masjid. And hopefully, inshallah, within the next week, we can have our carpet laid down. We're working on our minbar and our sound system. So inshallah ta'ala, if you guys want to be a part of that, I know there were a couple people who reached out to me via DM maybe a couple weeks ago. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help Gen Z. May Allah help Gen Z. If you could only see how tight this boy's pants are, man, subhanAllah. I was looking this way because the young guy was coming to park next to me, and he was parking really sloppy, and I was just like, this guy getting ready to hit my car, man. So he parks, and he's still mad crooked, and he gets out the car, and he's walking towards the mall, and this man's pants is so tight. My gosh, man. It's just like, man, what are you... Where's your father? Because there's no way in the world one of my sons would be coming outside looking like that. Where is your father, man, to put his foot square in your behind, man? Why are your pants so tight? I don't understand that, man. Like, may Allah help Gen Z, man. Y'all, man, subhanAllah, man. Anyway, Lord have mercy, man. I know it hurts to walk in tight pants. No, I was looking over here because he's like parking like mad crazy. I'm about to roll my window down like, yo, what are you doing, man? Do you need help parking? Do you need help parking? And then as I'm talking to you guys, he gets out and he walks. And I'm just like, what in the world? My gosh, man. Anyway, back to the masjid opening. Right, exactly. Use my inside voice. Okay, so alhamdulillah. So, Masjid, Rawda Islamic Center of Delaware, inshallah ta'ala, will be opening in January. We were shooting for the last week of December. There's some work that has to be done on the inside, inshallah ta'ala, some painting and some things need to be removed and moved. So inshallah ta'ala, we're focused on laying the carpet down now. I'm going to meet the guy over there probably in an hour or so when he gets here. He's driving all the way down from Connecticut, alhamdulillah, to come measure our facility to lay down the carpet for our masjid. Alhamdulillah, we have a great space. We have a nice, decent sized space. Alhamdulillah, enough space for the brothers and for the sisters. We have ample parking. Alhamdulillah. And I'll keep you guys updated. By Friday, inshallah ta'ala, I'll have more details for you. But for right now, what we're focusing on is our carpet, putting the carpet down. And alhamdulillah, as you know, Rova Islamic Center of Delaware, if you've ever been to one of our events, you know, we like to choose the highest quality of everything that we can afford. Alhamdulillah, we don't like to skimp on anything. This is the standard that we have always operated with as a community. So alhamdulillah, the carpet that we are going to choose is the thickest, most comfortable carpet that we can choose. Alhamdulillah, we don't want the believers having to sit on the floor. And you know, the padding under it is high quality, and the carpet is high quality, alhamdulillah. So we are looking at a total of around $12,000. That is what we're looking at right now to carpet our masjid. So our Cash App is pinned down at the bottom, Rawdah, R-A-W-D-A-H, capital I, capital C, Rawdah, I-C, meaning for Islamic Center. So if you would like to be a part of the carpet process, just think, if you donate to carpet the masjid, every time somebody comes into the masjid, prostrates on that carpet, you get the reward for that, because you helped lay the carpet down. You helped purchase what would be the carpet for a masjid. And it's, you know, it's such a blessing, you know, to be able to cash in on something like this. So here again, I'm just extending the opportunity to you. Alhamdulillah, the carpet will be laid one way or another. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't beg. I extend opportunities. So you can either say, oh man, I ain't contributing to that. Alhamdulillah, your loss. Because somebody else will contribute to it. At any rate, the masjid will be carpeted with you or without you. So it's on you. A lot of times we have this mentality that, oh, I'm not donating. Or soon somebody start talking about donations. All right, I'm out. I'm all this will donate and stuff. Okay, you just forfeited the opportunity, because it's going to happen with you or without you. One way or another, it's going to happen. I'm just extending the opportunity to you for you to cash in on it. $100 here, $500 there, $1,000 here. I would love for one person to say, you know what, Shadid, I got 10 grand to carpet the masjid. The same way the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when the camel kneeled in the place where that was, they were going to build the masjid. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he turned to the Sahaba and said, you know, who's going to take care of this? And the Uthman said, I got it. I got it. The property where the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's masjid is belonged to two orphans. Their parents left them that property, left them that piece of land. And when the camel sat down on that piece of land, those two young boys went to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and said, we'll give it to you for free. You're building a masjid here. We'll give it to you for free. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, no, you guys are orphans. Your parents left you that, or your father left you that land. I'm not going to take anything from you for free. And Uthman said, name your price. I got it. I'll take care of it. Give me a price. Done. Take care of it. That is the type of energy that we are looking for when it comes to masjid projects. We're looking for people who are going to donate their time, their money to say, you know what, whatever is needed, we'll take care of it. It always blows my mind how we drive around in such nice vehicles. We pride ourselves on not having rent. You know, I pay a mortgage because I own my house. We pride ourselves on so many materialistic things. But when it comes to the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I'm speaking to the African-American Muslim community, because our masajid are the worst looking masajid out of all other communities in America. I'm speaking specifically to the African-American Muslim community. Our masajid, if you want to even call them that, our masajid are the worst looking places in America. amongst all populations of the Muslim community. We always have some hole in a wall, rented place in the most obscure places on the planet, in the most darkest alleys, the most, you know. And I mean, like, sometimes you pull up like, this is the masjid, and you're scared to go in there. Like, I mean, why is this the standard for the African-American Muslim community? Why is this our standard? And we take so much pride in it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was living with Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. He had two wives at the time that he migrated, Sauda bint Zam'a and Aisha. He had two wives when he migrated from Mecca to Medina. He had two wives. And instead of arriving in Medina and having his home built first, he lived with Abu Ayyub al-Ansari until the masjid was built first. You understand this? So there's a priority here. There's a prioritization when it comes to building the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They prioritize the masjid. So we do the total opposite in today's time. We live in nice homes, drive nice vehicles, walking around with $1,000 shoes on our feet, get on social media, bragging, unboxing, and, you know, doing all of this stuff. And our masajid look like holes in the wall. I never forget, I came to Delaware years ago. This was like the first time I ever came to Delaware. This was like in 2006. And here again, the African-American masjid. And I remember it was the summertime, summer of 2006. And the masjid where I was at, the sisters area didn't have any air conditioner. Didn't have an air conditioner, or the air conditioner was not working. My wife is downstairs. She texts me. She's like, can you ask the brothers for somebody to go purchase a fan or something? Because we are literally downstairs burning up, man. There's no air conditioner. We got one little fan. It barely works. So I stopped my lecture. I stopped my lecture because my family is a priority. When I go to the masjid, what determines if I'm coming back to the masjid is how my family felt when they came to the masjid. How did you feel? Did you feel welcome? Did the sisters welcome you? My kids, did you feel like you were relegated to one little area? Did somebody yell at you? How did you feel? And if they told me they had a great experience, then inshallah ta'ala, we'll be back. But that is the determining factor for me whether or not this is a place that I want to come back to. And that is did my family feel welcomed? We go to a place and my wife, my children tell me they did not feel welcome. We will never come back. I will never come back. My family is the priority. I don't care how they treat me, because we look at speakers like a celebrity. So you're going to give celebrity, you know, top tier treatment. But how does my wife feel? How does my children feel when they go on the sister side? They don't feel welcome. They don't feel like it's a place that they can be comfortable with, comfortable at. We're never coming back. We're good. We're good. Because the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be a place that you feel comfortable. The house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be a place that you feel welcomed. So the Prophet with Abu Ayyub al-Ansari until the masjid was built. And when the masjid was built, then he began working on building his house. So he prioritized the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He prioritized the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while we prioritize our houses. Here again, that individualistic mentality. We are individuals within a community setting. We function as individuals. So alhamdulillah, we are at the stage. It's a slow process, but alhamdulillah, we're making some traction. Today, inshallah ta'ala, the guy's gonna come out. He's gonna measure the space for the masjid, the dimensions of the musalla floor. And inshallah ta'ala, hopefully by this time next week, inshallah, we'll have the carpet laid down. We'll have our speaker system set up. We'll have our minbar ready, and inshallah ta'ala, we'll be prepared for hopefully the first Friday in January. I'll keep you guys posted. We're aiming for the first Friday in January, inshallah ta'ala, which is right after our winter conference, inshallah. If we can get it done before then inshallah ta'ala, we'll try to do that. But for right now, we are aiming for the masjid being open the first Friday in January. So please keep us in your dua, inshallah ta'ala, and all donations are welcome. So if you want to help with the masjid carpet project, we are in need of $12,000. Alhamdulillah, I saw some Cash App donations come in. Alhamdulillah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all. But it's a slow process, but you know, alhamdulillah, we're making traction. So our carpet project is $12,000. Once we get the carpet laid down, that's probably the biggest thing that we need to do. Once we lay the carpet down, inshallah ta'ala, then you know, we'll have simultaneously the guy working on our speaker system. Sisters area, inshallah, we have sisters in the community that's going to make sure y'all area is, you know, immaculate. Alhamdulillah, we prioritize the women in our community at Rotha Islamic Center of Delaware, so the sisters are going to make sure the sister side is immaculate. The brothers, we don't necessarily require much, but for the women, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to make sure that the sister side is immaculate and pretty much everything that you would need on a sister's side to feel comfortable. Alhamdulillah, we prioritize our women. We don't put our women in a basement somewhere, some closed off corridor of the facility where they can barely hear, barely see. No, we prioritize our women, alhamdulillah. So our Cash App is posted down at the bottom, Rotha IC. If you would like to use Zelle, then you can use the masjid's phone number, 302-766-5389. That's 302-766-5389. Once again, if you want to use Zelle, it's 302-766-5389. Alhamdulillah. So as the masjid carpet project is ongoing, I'll stream it live once we get the carpet in and they start laying it down, and you guys can see where your money is going. Alhamdulillah. I always like to be transparent to show you where your money is going. When they knock the masjid down, when they knock the building down, I wanted to stream that live so you guys can see that for those of you who donated, that's where your money went. The carpet project, that's where your money is going. So alhamdulillah, we're getting some, you know, we're making some waves, alhamdulillah. Please keep us in your dua. If you don't have the finances to assist, or you don't have it like that to assist, then assist with dua. Make dua for us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us successful. We have our musalla is 3,000 square feet. So if you know anything about square footage, that's a pretty decent size space. Alhamdulillah. 3,000 square feet. That is a pretty decent size square footage for a musalla. So alhamdulillah, we have the highest quality, highest grade of padding as well as the carpet. So the carpet will be very thick. The padding is thick so that when we go down in sujood or we sit on the musalla floor, alhamdulillah, you don't have to worry about hurting your knees or sitting on something that's, you know, puts you right there next to the floor. You will be sitting on padding and, you know, no, masjid carpet is not cheap. Not at all. And this is actually the second guy that I went to. The first guy gave me a quote of $23,000. I'm just like, yeah, nah. There has to be a better way. You know, there has to be a better way. So, alhamdulillah, we opted for another brother, alhamdulillah. And this brother, mashallah, I'm going to tell you a little something about this brother, man, just to show you how small the world is. So, I reached out to this other brother, and he does carpeting for many of the masajid throughout America and Canada. Right, most of the masajid that you go to, big masajid that you go to, and the carpet is very nice, he did the carpet for that. And as I'm talking to him yesterday, he says, you know, we're kind of talking on a personal level, and he said, brother, I wanted to he said, I want to share something with you. I said, sure, go for it. He said, are you aware of the company Edible Arrangements? And I was like, yeah, of course. He said, I started that company. I said, no way. He said, I started that company. You know, me and my brother, we started that company. He said, and then, you know, my brother, you know, is, I guess, the older brother. He's a Pakistani brother. He's like, you know, my brother, you know, kind of wanted to take over the company or whatever. And he said, you know, we were kind of fighting back and forth, you know, over it. And he said, my mother told me, you know, just give it to your brother, you know, just give it to him. You know, don't fight over money. Money will follow you. You don't chase money. Money will chase you. He said, you know, you and your brother, you know, just give it to him. Give it to him and then, you know, go start something else. He said, so I gave the edible arrangement to my brother. He said, and the company that it is today, he said, that is all my brother. He said, but I was the one that came up with the idea for it. And I was like, wow. He said, so I always had a love for going to masajid, going to the masjid. I love going to the masjid. He said, so when I gave my brother the company, he said, I made dua. He said, oh Allah, bless me with a business that will allow me to continue to be in the masjid. He said, and then I got the idea to start carpets, doing carpets for the masajid. And it's a multi-million dollar company, and he gets to go into the masajid, spend a lot of time. Just think about the time that he spends in the masjid laying down carpet. Man, subhanAllah al-Azim. I was blown away, man. Blown away, man. SubhanAllah al-Azim, man. Such a small world, man. But that is what Allah means when he says, "Wa amma bi ni'mati rabbika fahaddith." And as for the favors of your Lord, then proclaim the blessings of your Lord. He said, I gave the company to my brother because my mother told me, don't fight over money. Don't fight over that. Money will chase you. You don't chase money. He said, best advice my mother ever gave me. Don't chase money. He said, so I gave the business to my brother. How do you just give a business to your brother and your brother turns the business into a multi-million dollar business? Edible arrangements is a multi-million dollar business. And then turn around and make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless you with a business that will allow you to spend time in the masjid, and you create a carpet company and you go around servicing the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, laying down carpet. Man, oh man. Talk about being blessed, man. Subhanallah al-Azim. So now you guys have some backstory. You have some context. Edible Arrangements is a Muslim-owned company. And Carpets, Mosque Carpets of USA is a Muslim-owned company that goes around and services the masajid laying down carpet. Most of your big masajid, because they deal in big projects. They deal in like big projects. They're not necessarily like the small little masajid. They don't necessarily reach out to companies like that because they charge. You know, he's not giving it to you for free. He's going to, you know, give you the Muslim discount, but he's not giving it to you for free. But most of the big masajid that you have ever been to between America and Canada, he has been responsible for laying the carpet down for them. So I just wanted to share that with you because he shared that with me. And I just thought it was just an amazing story, man. SubhanAllah al-Azim. Who would have known that I would pick up the phone? And I was referred to him by somebody else that I was also dealing with, who was his partner. And I was kind of getting frustrated with the partner because he was taking too long to get back to me. And I'm just like, listen, man, if you got somebody else you can refer me to, then just refer me to. I don't like doing business like this, blah, blah, blah. And he was like, here's my partner's number. And he sent me the number and the brother texted me. I called him. And who would have known, man? Who would have known? SubhanAllah. So all of you fighting over businesses, fighting over stuff with your siblings, sometimes it might be better to just give it to them because Allah has something else in store for you. There's such a beautiful lesson in that. You come up with the idea, your brother comes in because maybe he's good at other things. And you know, you got that one sibling that just comes in and brodies and just takes over everything. And then, you know, mom steps in and mom says, just give it to him. Now, for the average person, they would have considered that oppression. Well, why I got to give it to him? It's my idea and I came up with it. Because you're fighting for something when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has something else planned for you. You're fighting for something that is small and insignificant in the grand scheme of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for you. Sometimes, here again, we block our own blessings. Because if he would have fought his brother for that company, he probably would have got the company, but he would have missed out on the opportunity to open up the carpet store, the carpet company, whereby he could have been in the masajid servicing the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fighting for crumbs when you got a whole loaf of bread on the table. Yep. Some of us fighting for crumbs while you got a whole loaf of bread on the table. SubhanAllah, such a lesson. Such a lesson. Fighting for crumbs while you have a whole loaf of bread on the table. If don't sweat the small stuff was a person. Don't sweat the small stuff. If that was a person, it would be this brother right here. Imran. Shout out to brother Imran. Mashallah. Tabarakallah. I appreciate him sharing, taking the time out to share that with me. And I appreciate you guys giving me an opportunity and let me share that with you. Yeah, man. That wasn't even what I was going to talk to you guys about today. But I mean, it was just on my mind. And I just was like, man, I actually told my wife, I'm like, yo, let me share with you what this brother just shared with me on the phone. It's crazy. Crazy, man. SubhanAllah, Ladeem. You know, and perhaps he needed to get that off his chest. You know, I gave him an ear, which I don't usually do. I don't usually get personal with people, but, you know, we just clicked so well when we were on the phone, alhamdulillah. So, masjid carpet project, alhamdulillah, we're looking at $12,000. If you have it to donate, alhamdulillah, today, if we can get you to donate $100 today, you can use our Cash App. You can use our, which is the Cash App posted, pinned down at the bottom, RAWDAH, Rawdah IC, Islamic Center. Or you can use our Zelle, which is the message phone number, 302-766-5389, 302-766-5389. Or you can go directly to our website, www.RawdahIslamicCenterOfDelaware.com. Please continue to support and help with the building of Rawdah Islamic Center of Delaware, alhamdulillah. So Friday, inshallah ta'ala, during the Friday night khutbah recap, I'll keep you guys posted. I'll update you on the who, what, when, where, and why, inshallah ta'ala. So I didn't want to get on today and give you too much information, just to let you know that we are still working here in Newark, Delaware, and we're looking at the first week of January, inshallah. We're just trying to make sure that we have everything prepared, so when we open our doors and welcome everybody in, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, you come into a nice place, a nice space that you feel comfortable and you feel at home. We want you guys to come to Delaware and visit the masjid and decide, you know what, it is so beautiful here, I'm going to move here. That's what I did. I came to Delaware in 2006, and I told my wife, we need to find a place here because we're not moving back to Newark, New Jersey. We're moving here to Newark, Delaware. I came here, I saw what it was, and I was like, check the school system out. My wife was looking at the schools and the school, you know, school system here. And I'm just like, yeah, man, this is a far better place to raise my kids than Newark, New Jersey. No pun intended. I love Newark. I love the whole Essex County, but probably not a great place to raise children. Not a great place to raise children. There are some other places that are far better, less invasive, that you can raise your children. So, you know, it's my children became my priority. So, just to drop a little jewel on you really quickly, I don't want to leave and just make it all about, you know, just the donations. But I also wanted to continue with our discussion on the culture of divorce. the culture of divorce. We have been talking about this for the longest. I will be giving the khutbah this Friday at Masjid al-Kawthar in Wilmington, Delaware. And we will be continuing with the culture of divorce, inshallah ta'ala. We will now start to walk through some of the protocols and some of the procedures that we should follow Islamically when it comes to divorce. There is a certain list of procedures and protocols that Islam mandates on both husband and wife to follow when they are in the transition of exiting their marriage. And unfortunately, in today's time, you find that the vast majority of Muslims do not follow these guidelines, do not follow these protocols, either due to our ignorance of them or either due to our, you know, just rebellion against the laws that have been legislated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whether the latter or the former, we need to get back in touch and aligned with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us and what was legislated for us in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is disheartening to see Muslims, you know, totally disregard what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in his book and what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam legislated in his sunnah. As it relates to marriage and divorce, it is sad to see Muslims totally disregarding these protocols, these guidelines, and making a mess of our communities. Making a total mess of our communities. Because nobody is following the protocol. No one is adhering to the guidelines. No one is adhering to the guidelines. I had a sister who reached out to me the other day. And she said, you know, I'm looking to get married, but, you know, like, how do I even pursue marriage? Do I walk up to a brother and give him my wali's number? She said, I gave a brother my wali's number and he never even called my wali. And I said, because Muslims don't function with that. They don't function with those guidelines anymore. Muslims don't get married the old school traditional way of the sister reaches out to her father or her wali. He goes to the brother. They make arrangements. They, you know, make arrangements to, you know, be in a setting with the sister, you know, in a protected environment where her priorities are prioritized. And they have what's called a sit down. We can't even call it sit downs anymore. A sit down is where there's a sister, the potential husband or brother, and the wali. That's a sit down. If it's not three people involved and one of those three people is the woman's father, her brother, her uncle, or the imam of the masjid, then it's not a sit down. It's a hookup. Understand the difference between the two. What we do today is not called a sit down. If sister, you and him are the only two people on the phone, if you and him are the only two people at the restaurant, if you and him are the only two people in the mall, if you and him are the only two people in the car, if you and him are the only two people involved in that process, then it is not a sit down. Don't say, I had a sit down with a brother, and if the wali wasn't there, if the father wasn't there, the imam of the masjid wasn't there, or someone the imam appointed was not there, it was a hookup, it wasn't a sit down. Muslims don't have sit-downs anymore. Sit-downs involve three people. Not two people in the shaitan. That's a hookup. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِذَا خَلَى الرَّجُ بِإِمْرَأَةٍ وَلَيْسَ مَعَهَا ذِي مَحْرَمْ فَشَيْطَانْ ثَارِثَهُمَا. That if a man is alone with a woman and she does not have her wali with her, then the shaitan is the third party. So if it's just two of y'all, then shaitan is the wali. And that's a hookup, not a sit down. If you and him are only two people on the phone and nobody else is on the phone along with y'all, then shaitan is the wali. And what y'all have is a hookup, not a sit down. You guys follow me? We don't even follow those traditional rules anymore. You either go to some Muslim matrimonial site and then you get whatever you get from that, or you do it the traditional way and you try to get married by word of mouth, networking within your own circle. Your friends, your circle of friends, do they know someone? Are they married? Does their husband know someone? Or your circle of friends, does their wife know someone? I mean, that's how most of my marriages, that's how it took place. I got married through somebody that I knew that knew someone. A brother that I was cool with, he knew that I was looking to get married. He knew that his wife had a younger sister. Let me introduce you to my younger sister. Alhamdulillah. And that's how it happened. Brother I know at the masjid, he reaches out to me, says, yo, my sister-in-law is looking to get married. My wife's sister is looking to get married. And that's the connection. So you network within your circle of friends. But I wouldn't advise going to a Muslim matrimonial site. People start to believe who they think they are. And they get on social media, and social media reinforces all of those superficial, delusional thoughts that people have about themselves. Most of the people on social media are delusional, which is why they get on social media to begin with. They're delusional because they tell themselves, I'm important, I'm someone, I'm this, I'm that. And then they get on social media and they project that image, and social media reinforces that. Meanwhile, in the real world, people don't see you to be like that. People don't see you as that. And that's why Gen Z is all messed up, because they spend most of their time on social media, but the real world doesn't function like that. And this is why they crash out in the real world, because they can't reconcile within their brain that the real world doesn't function like social media. So they crash out in the real world. Quitting jobs, killing people in broad daylight, just doing dumb stuff. The jails are about to be filled with Gen Z. The jails are going to be filled with Gen Z. They are a self-destructive generation. They are a self-destructive generation. From about 17, 18 to about 32. Self-destructive generation, man. Most of the men in Gen Z are going to be in prison. And it's sad, man. Because they can't reconcile that the real world doesn't function like social media. The real world and social media are two totally different places. And they can't reconcile that. Anyway, so it's important for us, you know, to follow, or the cemetery. Yeah, you're right about that. Yep, you're right about that. 20 years from now, whoever's left of Gen Z, you know, they will be a small population. They will be a small population, because most of them crashed out. Most of them are dead or in prison. So it's important for us to follow the protocols of the Quran and the Sunnah when it comes to marriage and divorce, when it comes to pretty much everything. But my concentration is on marriage and divorce. So this Friday, inshallah ta'ala, I will be giving the khutbah at Masjid al-Kawthar in Wilmington, Delaware, and we will be continuing our discussion about divorce. So if you've never heard about these guidelines and protocols related to divorce, go back and take a listen to all of the khutbahs that I've given, you know, in the month of November all the way up until now, and continue to listen, because we're going to go through a lot of the Islamic guidelines and protocols as it relates to divorce, some of which people have never even heard before. And maybe imams or students of knowledge are a little reluctant to talk about this, because Jumu'ah is supposed to be, you know, uplifting and inspiring. But I believe that, yes, Jumu'ah should be uplifting and inspiring. But when you're dealing with a generation of people who are so distant and disconnected from the Quran, then you have to pivot a little bit as an imam, as a student of knowledge, realizing what you are dealing with, and seizing the opportunity on Jumu'ah to be able to feed these brothers and sisters the information that they need to empower them. Information, knowledge of the deen is inspiring and empowering, period. sometimes it's about the delivery, but knowledge and information about the deen is empowering. There are so many young teens in jail for double and triple homicides in North New Jersey. Yeah, trust me, I know. SubhanAllah, Al-Azim. I was extended an opportunity to go to the juvenile facility to work with some of the juveniles here in Delaware. I can't do it. I can't do it. I don't even know how to relate to them. They need somebody from their generation to be able to speak to them in a way that they would be receptive to. I don't know how to. Because I remember myself at 16 years old, and there was really nothing that you could tell me at 16, 17. There's nothing you could tell me. I didn't want to hear anybody. There was nothing you could tell me. I didn't want to hear anything from anybody. And so for some of our children, unfortunately, experience has to be their teacher. For some of our children, experience has to be their teacher. Because they don't listen to anybody. So experience has to be their teacher. Some of them are going to make it after a long and arduous path. And unfortunately, some of them are not going to make it. Some of them are not going to make it. I appreciate that, but nah. I'll pass on that. Leave that for somebody else. I'll leave that for somebody else. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. Jazakumullahu khairan. Please continue to support and aid Rotha Islamic Center of Delaware. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all and make your affairs easy. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Please take advantage of the opportunities in the morning to make dua for yourself, for your families, for the Muslim community at large. I do think that, we are headed in a good direction. As a community, as a whole, I do think that, you know, here on the East Coast, we've been through a lot. We've been through a lot of turmoil. So a lot of Muslims, they move to like Texas, or they move to Atlanta, they move to other places. And these are like kind of like Muslim utopias, you know, and while that might be great, the communities up here, New York, New Jersey, Philadelphia, all the way up to probably Baltimore, D.C., we've been through a lot in the past 20 years, you know, and in the past 15 years, we've been through a lot and, still going through a lot, but alhamdulillah, I can kind of see some type of light at the end of the tunnel. I can see some type of light at the end of the tunnel. And I pray that, you know, my intuition is not delusional, is not failing me. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you too, brother. Alhamdulillah. Much appreciated. Please don't forget our winter conference coming up December, the weekend of December 20th to the 22nd. Alhamdulillah, here in Newark, Delaware, at the Hilton Hotel. We do have a kitchen. We do have a kitchen in the masjid. Alhamdulillah. We do have a kitchen. And we have a little small area for a store. So we will be selling, you know, Islamic books, garments, you know, things like that. So to help offset some of our costs, alhamdulillah. So we do have a store area connected to the masjid, and we do have a kitchen. Alhamdulillah, we have two bathrooms. It's not like a cathedral type of masjid. It's a fairly decent sized space. But here again, you know, everything in moderation, you know. But if you would like to contribute and help and assist, then alhamdulillah, by all means, please get involved. Please let this become part of your legacy that I assisted the masjid, I aided and I supported the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you die, you're going to see all of those hasanat, all of those good deeds waiting for you on the other side. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his forgiveness for any shortcomings we may have. Inshallah ta'ala, I'll keep you guys posted. Jazakumullahu khairan. Is it possible to connect with the masjid to sell natural skincare products, handmade? Yes, of course. Of course. Of course. I mean, you can put, you know, once we sort out everything, you know, that's not necessarily the priority or the focus right now. Right now, the focus is laying the carpet down, getting our speaker system ready, They're going to come in and paint next week, inshallah. So we'll have a fresh coat of paint on the walls. You know, clean up the outside area a little bit so people can have parking. We have ample parking space. Alhamdulillah, we have parking and we have entrances on both sides. So we'll have an entrance for the brothers, an entrance for the sisters. Alhamdulillah. Yeah, alhamdulillah. Security, definitely security. Alhamdulillah. So we'll keep you posted. But if you shoot an email to contact Rolda Islamic Center at gmail.com, inshallah ta'ala, then, you know, just kind of keep us updated, or we'll keep you posted. Once we open up the store, inshallah, you'll have first dibs, inshallah. How's the school system in Delaware? School system is great. School system is great. I mean, they're not the top schools in America, but nonetheless, the school system here is pretty, there's a hierarchy of schools. You have your lower tier schools, you know, that don't really graduate, don't push out, maybe graduate 50-60% of the graduates. And then you have, you know, depending on where you put your children, you know what I mean? As a parent, it's your responsibility to look at the school system and look at the hierarchy of schools that are here and to choose the best schools to put your children in. There are a lot of people taking shahada in the hood, but the imams just leave them with only that. Yeah, trust me, I know. I know. I gave a young brother shahada. Yeah, there are about three or four Islamic schools in Delaware. Yes, they're Islamic schools. As a matter of fact, the Islamic Academy of Delaware just opened up 9th grade this year. So, and I think that they're going to open up 10th grade next year. I think they're going to kind of stair step it, and until they have the entire school, high school, filled. So alhamdulillah, that's a great thing, you know, because they, for all of the years that we've been here, that we've never had a Muslim high school. So alhamdulillah, this year was the first year that they opened up 9th grade, and I think next year they're going to open up 10th grade, and they'll continue to open up the high school. So alhamdulillah, it's great. It's great. I think Tarbiyah Academy has, Tarbiyah School has online, high school online. So, you know, alhamdulillah, there are options. There are options. You know, there are options. I had to pull my 16-year-old out of school this year. So he's homeschooling. He's doing school from home. He was going to public school, and, you know, I wasn't feeling it. I wasn't feeling it at all. And I told him, next year, you're not going into school. You will homeschool. You will do school from home. Alhamdulillah. So alhamdulillah, he's doing homeschooling. And a lot of parents are opting for homeschooling. And I think that that's great. If you know how to homeschool, I think that's great. Do I need volunteers for the opening? Of course we do. Please send an email to contact Rolda Islamic Center, inshallah ta'ala. Once we do our grand opening, inshallah, for Jumu'ah, of course, we're going to feed everybody. We'll have food. You know, vendors will be able to come out, and, you know, we'll keep everybody posted, inshallah ta'ala. All right? Step by step. Shaitan for Shaitan. So once again, our Cash App is Rolda, R-A-W-D-A-H, Rolda, I-C, pinned down at the bottom. And our Zelle is the message's phone number, 302-766-5389. 302-766-5389. Unfortunately, not wheelchair accessible. Unfortunately, not, at least for now, not wheelchair accessible. Unfortunately, we are sorry about that, but, you know, a little bit at a time, you know, we can only accommodate but so much. Any plans for Rolda opening a school in the future? Of course. Of course. That goes along with the institutions. Something that I was talking to an older brother yesterday about, you know, older brother in North Carolina, and he was, he wanted to invite me to come down to North Carolina. And he said, you know, a lot of the African-American Muslims in North Carolina, they don't, you know, they don't have the ability to invite speakers. And I said, I know, because they don't own property. They don't own institutions. If you are attending a masjid, then you got to go to the imam, you got to go to the board of administration, you got to ask permission to invite this speaker or that speaker, you know, who you know is on the haq, and, you know, you're left to their mercy because you don't have any institutions. This is the point that we are missing. We cannot establish Islam without institutions. That is masajid, that are schools, that are institutes, that are owned and operated and ran by us. If we do not have that, then we're always going to be left with renting out a hotel, asking, you know, this imam or this board of administration to use their masjid to invite our speakers or invite speakers that we are fond of, or, you know, that we consider speakers or lecturers. You know, we're always going to be at the mercy of somebody else because we don't have institutions. And we dropped the ball on that 20 years ago. And you can say what you want to say about the Nation of Islam or the brothers and sisters from the Wharf Dean community. They understood that concept. I went all the way to Bermuda, and there was a nation of, there was a building, one of the biggest masajid in Bermuda, that was purchased by the Nation of Islam. Purchased by the Nation of Islam. They all over the world buying property to preach their dawah while we just sit on the phone on the minbars and just yap. Haven't established anything. You can't establish anything without institutions. Masajid, schools, institutes, businesses. You can say what you want to say about the Nation of Islam. These guys went all over the world purchasing properties, buildings, to set up their institutions to give dawah. To give dawah. One of the biggest masajid in Bermuda, gifted to them by the Nation of Islam. Built by the Nation of Islam for their dawah. For their preaching, their teaching, replete with a school on the top floor, everything. Bottom floor is a musalla, top floor, a school. It's no longer in existence now, but the property is still there. The masjid that I gave the lecture at in Bermuda, that was the masjid that I was in. But here again, we don't believe in establishing institutions. We talk a good one, but you got to put your money where your mouth is. Sacrifice. Where are the Salafi institutions? Where are the Sunni Orthodox, Sunni Muslim institutions? Where are they? Where? You got a few here, a few here, few holes in the wall, few little small little places here and there, but we really haven't made an impact in our environments. We really haven't made an impact in our environments. Where's the Sunni Islamic schools owned and operated by African-American Muslims? We went all over the world to study Islam. We went to Yemen. We went to Egypt. We went to Morocco. We went to Saudi Arabia. We went all over the world to study Islam. And you have all of these brothers and sisters who know Arabic, can read the Quran, can speak all of this fancy Arabic. Come back to America to do what? To work for somebody else's school. To work for somebody else's masjid. You don't see the problem with that? And I didn't just start saying this yesterday. I didn't just start saying this yesterday. I've been saying this for years. For years. We'll figure it out at some point. But we can't establish Islam and the correct approach to Islam that we believe we have until we have the institutions that will become the foundations upon which we establish our dawah. They become the foundation. And even after we die, those institutions are still here. Those institutions are still here. People will say, oh, that building used to be owned and operated and ran by, you know, the Salafi community or the Sunni Orthodox Sunni Muslim community. They had this building. They had this school. They had the institutions will still be there. Long after we're gone. But no, We're too busy priding ourselves on the type of cars that we drive around in and the type of houses that we live in and the type of garments that we're wearing for Jumu'ah. Like, we just always minoring in the major and majoring in the minor. Always. Or the Islamic schools get closed down. Yep, absolutely. Yep. Not enough funding. We put our children in the Islamic school and then we have grossly exaggerated expectations. It's like you put your children in public school, you didn't have any expectations, but then you come to the Muslim school and you got all of these grossly exaggerated expectations. Like, your child is not going to be Hafiz Quran in 3 years when you don't review the Quran with them at home. Why has my son been in the school for 3 years and he still don't know how to read Arabic? How much Arabic homework have you done with your child? We're not miracle workers. School, we're going to provide you with the foundation. Home is where the real teaching goes on. If you're not following up with your students, following up with your children at home, how in the world are you going to come to the school and voice your opinion, your frustration at the school as if it's the Muslim school's problem? Meanwhile, you don't do anything with your children at home. You just want a microwavable teaching of Islam. Just pop it in the microwave and they come out ready. You know, send them to the Muslim school and they come home Hafiz Quran. That's not the way that it works. And so then we get frustrated with the Muslim school. We pull our children out and put them in public school. Does that make sense? What sense does that make? And then you put your child in public school and you have no expectation. But then they go to the Muslim school and your expectations are grossly exaggerated. Gotta be kidding me, man. And that doesn't take the blame off a lot of the Muslim schools. There's a lot of room for improvement in the Muslim schools. There is. There is a lot of room for improvement in the Muslim schools. I'll be the first one to say that. A lot of room for improvement. But pulling your children out of a Muslim school and putting them into public school because your expectations of the Muslim school were grossly exaggerated is crazy work. Crazy work. Now you have no expectations. Yeah, so I'm not excusing the Muslim schools. The Muslim schools have a lot of work to do, have a lot of improvement. But for the parents, we got to get involved. You got to get involved. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. I would love to sit here and to, you know, continue this discussion with you guys, but I have to go, inshallah ta'ala. So I'll keep you posted with the masjid carpet project. Continue to donate, continue to support, inshallah ta'ala. And let's get this project underway so we can get started with our community bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Jazakumullahu khayran wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama taslima kathira wa subhanaka rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al-mursaleen walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa salamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.